this one.
With my phone, sure. Quick show of hands just to get a feel for the audience. Who here has ever used MongoDB or something? Okay. And who here has experience with IPython notebooks? Ah, that's a different part of the crowd. Maybe I can bring some people together. About me, my name is Jens. I'm a software engineer. I trade for a long time already. I used to work at ServNet, that's where I started, 2 years, and then I did a couple of years at Layar, an augmented reality startup in Amsterdam. Since a bit more than a year, I work for Optiver, which is a financial company. We are what we call an electronic market maker. We trade all around the globe, in Brazil, Chicago, Amsterdam, Paris, London, Sydney, Shanghai. And we are also often called a high-frequency trader. And because of that, we do millions of market actions per day. So that's sending an order to an exchange, updating orders, deleting orders, basically trying to buy and sell all kinds of financial products. I'll explain a bit more about electronic market making, what it is, but has anyone any idea what an electronic market maker does? Well, cool.
Make a lot of money.
We try to make a lot of money. Sometimes that works, sometimes that doesn't. Depends on the markets and depends a lot on how good we are at what we do. And that's what my presentation is about, measuring how good we are at what we do, at least one part of it. I'm not going to claim that the solution that I built, that I'm going to explain in a minute, is the best solution ever for this problem. But part of the reason that I chose to go with MongoDB and IPython is that I did not know what the best solution was when I started, but I still wanted results in a relatively short period of time. And that's where MongoDB helped me a lot, because it's very flexible. That's also a pitfall. And everything I did was on MongoDB 2.5, 2.6, when I started this project last year. Last March, MongoDB released a new major version, 3.0. It has some new features, it has some things slightly differently. So details may vary if you pick up MongoDB now. But I think the approach still stands, and 2.6 is also still widespread use. So, trading, exchange trading in the 21st century. Basically, everything is electronic. On the left side of the screen, you see basically what is us, Optiver. We have computers that do trades. So if they want to trade something, they send an order to the exchange and saying, hey, I want 100 stocks of Philips at 150 euros. And that arrives at the gateway. The gateway is a very dumb machine that basically just picks up orders and sends them on to the central component. Many exchanges have a lot of those. The matching engine is the single point where everything happens. Whoever gets first at the matching engine gets first pick. And whatever happens on the exchange then gets fed into a feedback loop through the market data publisher and back to every market participant. So we do this, IMC does this, Flow Traders does this, banks do this, hedge funds do this. And the 20th century open outcry trading with a lot of people gesturing with their hands and waving and yelling and shouting is almost a thing of the past. It still exists for very specific products in very specific markets, but basically all trading, exchange trading, in stocks, in options, in futures, in whatnots, is electronic with computers. Should not surprise any of you, actually. Electronic trading, 3 years. This is a graph. Resolution is kind of lower than I was hoping for. Left side, it starts in January 99 when Eurex, German exchange, switched from open outcry trading to what we call screen trading, electronic trading. So response times, so round trip times from sending an order to the exchange and getting something back, was started at 300 milliseconds, quickly dropped to around 100. And trading volume was maybe a million transactions per day across everything. And you see that steadily past 15 years, the response time, the processing time has gone down from 300 milliseconds to under one. And volume has exploded, especially you see one spike, that's 2008, that's the financial crisis. 2011, there's a lot of activity as well, and it seems to have stabilized a bit. Last years have been quieter than around 2010. But it shows what an amazing development electronic trading has gone through the last 15 years, and it's only a field that's 15 years old. So computer science is 40 years, 50 years, 60 years, some would argue. But electronic trading only started 15 years ago. So, what was my project about? What did I do? Like I said, in electronic trading, the response time of the exchanges are going down drastically, and it means that basically it's very important to be fast when you're trading. Because if you're slow, if you're slow at processing price changes, if you're slow at sending your orders out, you basically trade at the wrong prices. And if you trade at the wrong prices, you lose money. Imagine a car salesman having a price sheet of last year, publishing it online. I think within a day he will have sold every car he has in the parking lot. Sounds good, but he invested money to get those cars in the parking lot in the first place. So now he has money, but no cars to sell anymore. Now imagine him looking at his price list and trying to buy cars back for his buy price. His price is last year's price. Nobody's going to sell a car to him anymore because of inflation and increased prices and everything. So now he's forced, if he wants to continue trading cars, he's forced to buy back cars at a higher price and he just sold them. So he makes an immediate loss and has no way to recover it. Same is with exchange trading, except that the time window is way shorter than a year. The time window is the order of seconds. Prices go up, go down, go up, go down, sometimes by a bit, sometimes by a lot. But if you have the wrong prices in the market, if your information is bad, then you will either buy at a loss or sell at a loss, or even worse, both. So it's very important for us to be fast, but also to know if we're fast, and if so, how fast we are. My project was to basically try to reconstruct the whole chain of events from seeing something change in the market, price change, new participant, that's going into our system. We have something like 600 servers trading. So going into our system, ending up somewhere, some component, some algorithm takes a decision to say, hey, I want to buy now or I want to sell now that this price information has come on. Sends an order to the exchange. And as soon as the order is on the wire to the network connection to the exchange, it's out of our hands. So we want to know what time did we take from one thing coming in, through the whole serialization, deserialization process, decision making, sending it back, what is our wire to wire from network to network latency. This is the chain of events. Exchange publishes something. We have to deserialize the protocol. It gets onto an algorithm that makes a decision to trade or not. If it decides not to trade, well, that's where it stops. But if it decides to trade, it sends back a serialized message to the exchange. Every exchange has its own protocols. We send it back on the network connection, and then if we're fast enough, we trade what we want. If we were slow, we didn't trade. We have a network monitor set up on incoming and outgoing lines, so we can see what's coming in and we can see what's going out. This is quickly amounts to terabytes of data in a couple of days. And what we want to know is basically from the two dotted lines, how long did it take to go through the whole loop? Situation, what did I have to work with? This system was to be built around an existing setup. So I had no power to make any modifications to our current setup. I just had to work with what was there and try to reconstruct what was going on. So I had a lot of log files. Some of them grow to 6 gigabytes per day. I had a lot of network data, like I said, hundreds of gigabytes per day. And I had one accounting database that kept some very critical marketing information that, that helped me. Most of this data is not reported in the log files, or just a stream of mostly gibberish and sometimes something valuable. Network data, a lot happens on the exchange. Prices get updated sometimes 10 times a second, sometimes 100 times a second. Only one of those packets is actually interesting to me. The rest is all just waste. So a very low signal to noise ratio. If you want to search these things linearly, you'll end up in March 2023 before you have a result. Structure of these log files and also of this network capture is partly undocumented. It's inconsistent across different trading algorithms because, well, this all grew, these systems grew over time. Some of these things were designed 10 years ago and evolved. And there was never a conscious effort to say, hey, let's log everything very, very super structuredly so we can analyze it later on. Didn't happen, but I still got the question to do this. And yeah, the data size is way too much to just fit in memory and do a few lookups on it. So enter MongoDB for me. MongoDB is a database, and they often call it a document store. It is, to me, a big bucket where you can put almost JSON objects, but it's not JSON. They have a format they call BSON, binary JSON, and it's way more efficient for storing and searching through. It also has a few caveats that I'll cover later. But it's great for messy data. Basically, you just have an object, a dictionary, a Python dictionary, you just say, save it to the database, it's saved to the database. You have another one, save it to the database. So what I did, I just ran through all these log files, any line that had interesting data to me, I put it into a dictionary and I dumped it in the database. It's very easy to run MongoDB in user space, which was a big benefit for me because a lot of our systems are pretty locked down for all kinds of security reasons, compliance reasons, regulators require great safety measures for anyone operating on a financial exchange. But I could just start a database server in my own home here and start talking to it immediately. And the way MongoDB works, it basically just memory maps your entire database. So the disk file just says, oh, load the memory, whatever you can. And if you have enough RAM, that means your entire database permanently lives in memory. But it still has indexes, it still has fast lookups. But if you ever decide to stop working or your machine needs the memory for something else, all the data is persisted to disk. It just gets slower, but it's still there, you don't crash. And yeah, what's nice about it over just keeping everything in memory by yourself is you get automatic indexes, you get automatic query language. So, doing the task that I set out to, after I put everything in MongoDB, I had to make sense of the chain of events. So I can see something on a network line coming in. I can see messages coming into the decision algorithm. There are some fields that correlate, some fields that match. So you try to, based on some time information and market information, you try to see, okay, I have this message here, something sold, Philip stock sold, 100 lots for 50 euros. Do I see a similar message coming in with in the same time frame, say 100 milliseconds or 200 milliseconds? And later on in the log, you see a decision to, hey, I'm also buying 50 Philip stocks for, or 100 Philip stocks for 50. Try to match all these up. This is pretty easy to do for humans, actually. Especially if you are experienced as a trader, it was easy to make these measurements or these chain of events reconstructed by hand. Computers suck at pattern matching. Computers need exact matches. So I had to do a lot of experimentation basically to see, okay, where does everything match 100%? What fields can I rely on? What fields are unreliable? So I had to dig through my data set a lot. And that is where I was really happy with IPython Notebook. Because what an IPython Notebook does basically, it combines the Python interpreter with a web interface that gives you the capabilities of a simple development environment. Getting an IPython Notebook is deceptively simple. Once you have IPython installed, you just say IPython Notebook, and it will usually start a notebook server, and it will start a browser for you. And what you basically see is this. You have input cells, and you have output cells. Whenever you just type Python as if it was a shell, except that you can go up and down, and you can select and copy and paste. And whenever you press Ctrl Enter, it will execute the current cell within the interpreter that's running in the background. Almost standard Python, except that you can go back and forth. It also has capabilities of visualizing because it's running inside the browser. So it has built-in support for matplotlib. Basically you say, I want to have matplotlib inline, and then plot the square of every number from 0 to 100, a graph. So I just had this little message clause here. Basically, whenever you call this representation, it returns its own message. You can go back and say, I don't want a default representation function, I want a HTML representation function. So when you call that, it will return a bit of HTML. And if you then ask the Python interpreter, hey, print my object, there you go. It now is bold and highlighted like a heading. What else can you do with IPython? You have, like I said, inline editing. You can go back and forth. You can draw graphs. You can render HTML. You can save and load your files. This is great for going home after a day and saying, okay, I'm done. Save everything, close everything. In the morning, you can pick it back up. If you do it with a regular shell, your whole context is gone. You have to basically either dump everything into a file or start over. Syntax highlighting, code completion. It's not an IDE in the sense of PyCharm or whatever, but it has some features to make your life easier. It runs as a web server, so if you open up your computer, you can share your IPython notebook with your colleagues. Sometimes that's very useful, sometimes it's dangerous, it kind of depends on the colleagues. What's also nice is that last week I saw an announcement from GitHub is that they now support rendering notebooks inside of GitHub. So if you have a cool example that you want to show to people, if you want people to play with, you save your notebook, you upload it to GitHub, and then you tell everybody, here's my notebook. So in general, IPython is a great place for hacking around if you don't yet know what you really need to do. It's a shell on steroids, it really helped me a lot in the discovery process of my whole project to figure out what is the data set that I'm dealing with here. So that was IPython. IPython is simple, especially getting started. Everybody that didn't try it yet, please just give it a spin for 10 minutes. If you don't like it, you're welcome. Also, I said MongoDB is easy to run. If you have it installed, or you can just download it and untar it, you don't even have to put it into any directory except your own home here. You make it a directory for the database. You say, start a Mongo server and store the data there, and then you have a running database server, just like that. You can daemonize it using fork and bitwap path to make your life a little bit easier and get your shell back, but in general, you can just run MongoDB in the foreground, connect to it, keep it running for a month. Worked fine for me. Getting rid of it, if you're done with experimenting, and you don't want your data anymore, it's just as easy. You either, if you're running in the foreground, you just Ctrl C, or if you're running in the background, then you kill the process, and then you just throw the directories away, and it's gone, as if it was never there. Using it once it's running is almost as simple. There's a great Python library for connecting to it. So you create a client, you say, I want access to a database called my database. I never created that, it's just there as soon as you access it. And inside MongoDB, everything is stored in what's called a collection. It's sort of similar to a table, but it's not a table, so they call it a collection. Like a database, you can just access a non-existent collection, and once you save something to it, it actually exists all of a sudden. And then you just start inserting dictionaries into it. And if you then call find method on that collection, it will find every dictionary in that collection and return it as a cursor, wrap it in a list, and then you get this output. A bit more advanced examples of finding stuff. So this is your query language. There is no query language per se. It's more like a query interface where you specify documents that should match whatever is in the database. So first query will find basically every document that has the fields mother equal to hamster and father equal to elder brothers. You can find subsets, or you can find multiple matches using the $in operator. You can use comparison, greater than, less than. And what's also funny about the decent format that MongoDB uses, it supports more data types than JSON, and one of them is datetime. Gets a bit messy sometimes, but if you're working a lot with date values, it also supports timestamps. It can be a big boon. What it also supports is regular expressions in its find queries. Let's see, other operators you can use is things like not. And instead of find, which returns you a cursor, which always is an iterator, you can also use find one, which just returns the first object that matches your criteria. This is completely different from typical relational ORMs that will throw an exception if there are more matches. It will just give you one document if something matches, and no documents if nothing matches. What you can also see is that a bit more complex queries, like the third one, that start to feel a bit like you're coding Lisp with all the brackets and the brackets in the brackets. But nothing to be done about that at the moment. Inserting and updating data. Inserting is simple. You just give it a dictionary. Like I said, it's stored to the database. You can give it a list of dictionaries, in which case it will store multiple documents at once. This is really great if you're loading, say, 10,000 or 100,000 lines, because it really cuts back on your database overhead if you just put them in batches of 1,000 instead of one. You can update. The naive update method doesn't update, it replaces. And I'm running out of time here. Okay. Like I said, the default update only replaces documents. You have other modifiers to only update fields that you want to match. You can use upsearch, which is basically update if something matches, and otherwise insert whatever I gave to you. You can update multiple documents. Default is that it only matches one. The update method was heavily overloaded in MongoDB 2.6. So since MongoDB 3, basically you have to use insert one and insert many, update one and update many. I'm going to go a bit faster. Indexes. Basically, you just ask MongoDB to ensure that there's an index on a certain field. And then if you launch a query that uses that field, it will use that index to ridiculously speed up your lookup. at least if the data set is large. You can have multi-field indexes, you can have ordering on indexes, which is usually only important if you care about the order of the results. One thing I really liked about MongoDB is that it has great support for index intersection. So if you don't know what your data set looks like, if you're still just trying to get cross-sections from it, you define six indexes on six fields that you find interesting, and whenever you query on three of those fields, it will automatically intersect the indexes for you to make your query as fast as possible. The syntax for indexes can get ridiculously complex. I found that single field indexes are almost always good enough. MongoDB, dangers of MongoDB. BSON is not JSON. This is something that's really bitten me a couple of times. 64-bit signed integers is the maximum integer that you can store in MongoDB. Try anything greater than that and it will just crash out horribly. It has support for more data types than JSON, so datetime, code, regular expressions, binary formats, internal IDs. This is all great if you just use MongoDB. It also means that you cannot just export anything you get from MongoDB to a JSON file, because a lot of these types are not by default serializable using the JSON library. Fortunately, they provide a library for that, which wraps all the special cases in their own notation. Then again, it's not really standard JSON anymore. And another thing that's annoying about MongoDB is it never returns disk space to the operating system. If you ever used something and you deleted a lot of your records, MongoDB will just sit on that. The only way to get your disk space back is either repairing the entire database, which means you have to take the server offline and usually wait a couple of hours and need a lot of spare disk space. So what I did, as I showed you in the example, every day when I'm done with my work, when I've done my analysis, I just store the data directory out. And it's definitely not a typical relational database server. It has very little isolation, it has no transactions, it doesn't give you any guarantees, but the upside is the flexibility. What did this get me, all this work? What you see here is on the vertical axis the time of day, and horizontal axis every dot is an action by us. So that's a message sending to the exchange. And on the horizontal axis is basically relative latency. So the closer something is to the left side of the graph, the faster our response time was. In the top you see histogram. So most of what we do is definitely within a very small window, a very small bandwidth, which is exactly what we want. But sometimes, if you dig deeper, you see things like this. So the first bunch, all of a sudden, we were three times or four times as slow as normal. If that happens a lot, it can cost you 10,000, 20,000 euros a time. Third one. Yeah, that's really something. I discovered this yesterday. I passed it on to the other trader developers. This is something they were definitely going to look at. Something very weird happened. This is not what's supposed to happen. So what did I do? I take something like 10 million events in a log file, 100 million network messages, and condense that into a data set of meaningful data points, a couple of thousands, that we can actually do something with. I had no idea a year ago that I would be able to do this, that I would be getting here. The flexibility of MongoDB and IPython notebook helped me through my whole discovery phase. And what I really like about it is that despite the fact that I started off with MongoDB as a just a scratchpad, just a place to temporarily store my data, it's still my primary backend for this whole analysis. But I've also discovered that it's not a replacement for the typical relational databases that people like to use for transactional systems, information systems. It's something completely different. So it was a bit of a fast end of the presentation, but
just a
time. I think there's one time for one more question. Yeah.
It seems like you're kind of debugging a black box. So you're you don't know what the algorithms are.
That's right.
But you are part of the company, so would it be possible to know what the algorithms are? Because now you could have coincidental correlations, right?
Yeah, so one thing I did, oftentimes I would go to the developers of the algorithms, and when I found something, ask them questions, hey, is this according to what the specifications of the algorithms are? And sometimes they would say yes, and sometimes they would say no. But like I said, a lot of this is either very fluid, so algorithms can change as well. And a lot of this grew organically. We have a lot of algorithms with different strategies, different approaches. So going to everyone and ask them, hey, how does it work? That would give me basically a full-time job just asking questions to people. So I discovered that there are some things that are set in stone. Some log lines are at least sort of standardized, which is the basis of everything that I do. And sometimes I would tell people, hey, looks like you changed this, can you please change it back because everything broke now. And because the people that develop these algorithms also use the data set that I produce a lot to find outliers, to find out-of-place behavior, are usually very willing to work with us to change things back to the way they were. But a very important consideration in the way this is set up, non-intrusively, is that these algorithms, these decision algorithms, need to be as fast as possible. I can ask them to log every step of their decision-making process, but that would just slow them down. So I don't always have that liberty.
Okay.